بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله، الصلاة والسلام على سيدنا رسول الله. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم. In the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful. All praise and thanks are due to Allah. We ask His help and forgiveness. And we seek refuge in Allah from the evil of our souls and our bad deeds. Whomever Allah guides, no one can lead them astray. Whomever Allah leads astray, no one can guide him. I bear witness that there is no God to be worshipped except Allah alone. I bear witness that Muhammad is his last messenger and his servant, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله عز وجل، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. وبعد، respected elders, dear brothers and sisters in Islam, we are still talking about the reality of this worldly life. And today, inshallah, I will start my khutbah with a hadith. When you hear it for the first time, you may understand something. But when you listen to the understanding of the ulama, you will realize something totally different. That hadith is reported by Imam Muslim in Sahihihi an Sayyidina Abi Huraira. أن النبي صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم قال: الدنيا سجن المؤمن وجنة الكافر. When you hear this hadith for the first time and you look at it for the first glance, you may realize, Subhanallah, why has Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created me? Allah has created me to put me in the jail as a believer. And if I am a disbeliever, I will be in the paradise, and this dunya to be a paradise for me. Then the first thing that comes to your mind when you hear this hadith. The ulama used to understand this hadith in a totally different way. الدنيا سجن المؤمن جنة الكافر. Imagine yourself that you have your driver license and you have a speed limit is 40 and you drive it at 60. So you may get a fine. Before going to drive, you can drink alcohol. Of course, you're Muslims, you drink, you don't drink alcohol. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. But for others, it's one of the regulations that we have. One of the limits. And you have some other regulations, some other limits while driving. Because you want to get your license. You want to go safe. The same thing when it comes to Islam. Any successful project in this life, it has some limitations and restrictions that you have to limit yourself within. If you want to get your master, your PhD, you must spend some time. You will have some limits. And in Islam is the most successful project ever that you have in your life. It's a project of the hereafter to get into the Jannah. So when you have some limitations, it's something normal. That's why this dunya is a prison for a believer, because always he limits himself, he limits his lusts and desires, so he can reach the paradise. And then I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to gather us all in the Jannah. Allahumma ameen ya rabbal alameen. I have here a story about Sayyidina Imam Ibn Hajar radiallahu anhu, the one who has explained Sahih al-Bukhari. Imam Ibn Hajar, يعني يسمونه أمير المؤمنين في علم الحديث. Imam Ibn Hajar, he has a title among the scholars. He's Amir al-Mu'mineen when it comes to the matter of hadith, ilm al-hadith. Imam Ibn Hajar, he was very rich. Allah has given him a lot of money, a lot of wealth. كان الإمام ابن حجر يسير ذات يوم مع حاجيته والقوم عن يمينه يمنة ويسرى فمر بمزارع فقير يحرث أرضا. هذا المزارع ليس مسلما. فنظر المزارع إلى ابن حجر وقال له: يا إمام، كيف أفهم حديث نبيكم محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم؟ الدنيا سجن المؤمن جنة الكافر، وأنا مع ما أنا فيه من الشقاء، وأنت مع ما أنت فيه من النعيم. فقال له أبو بن حجر يا هذا أنت مع ما أنت فيه من الشقاء فأنت في جنة بالنسبة لما ينتظرك من العذاب في الآخرة، وأنا مع ما أنا فيه من النعيم فأنا في سجن بالنسبة لما ينتظرني من النعيم يوم القيامة في الجنة. Ibn Hajar رضي الله عنه, one of the biggest hadith scholars in Islam, he was walking one time with his companions surrounding him on his both sides, riding his horse, and he passed by a poor farmer farming his land. So that poor farmer, he is no believer, he looked at the Imam Ibn Hajar and said to him, Ya Imam, how can I understand the hadith that your Prophet saying, how can I understand your Prophet saying, this worldly life is a prison for the believers and in the Jannah for the disbelievers. And you can't see. Now I'm poor and you're very rich. فَقَالَ لَهُ الْإِمَامِ The Imam Ibn Hajar said to him, I am whatever I have in this dunya of pleasures and luxuries, it is nothing compared to the pleasure that I will have in the hereafter in the Jannah. And whatever you're suffering, whatever hardships you have in this life is nothing compared to the tortures and the punishment that you will receive in the hellfire in the afterlife. And so how we understand this hadith? الدنيا سجن المؤمنين وجنة الكافر. Still the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is teaching us how to understand this dunya. You should change your mentality when you deal with al-hayat al-dunya. روى الإمام البخاري عن سيدنا عبد الله بن عمر رضي الله عنهما أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أخذ بمنكبيه وقال يا عبد الله بن عمر كن في الدنيا كأنك غريب أو عابر سبيل. It's very easy to understand, but it's very, very, very difficult to apply that. And Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, Sahih Bukhari, one time he called Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Umar and he took hold of his shoulder. Like when you call your son and you want to teach him something very important, you get him closer to you, say, my son, I'm saying something important, please pay attention. And you put your arms on his shoulder, say, please memorize, huh? Or act upon that. And he said, Ya Abdullah ibn Umar, be in this world as a stranger or a traveler, a wayfarer, radiallahu anhu Abdullah ibn Umar. How can I understand that? It's very easy to understand. If you're going to visit one of your brothers, but you don't have any business with them, you don't have any relations, you're just going to visit him for the sake of Allah and you're coming back. Do you have any plans to stay in his place forever? Of course not. Do you have any plans to stay over there? So that's how you should deal with this dunya. أو عابر سبيل, or a traveler. Imagine yourself that you're traveling to another country that is worse than your own country. I'm not talking about Canada. We came together because we have better opportunities, better job, more money. Most of us are refugees. That's fine. But if you're going to another country which is worse than your own country, just to finish something over there, so it teaches us to reach your destination, finish everything, and to come back immediately. You don't have any plans to stay in that country because your home city, your home country is better for you. So the same mentality you should have when you deal with this dunya. The direction of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. It doesn't mean that you just stay in the masjid and you worship Allah, recite the Quran, and that's it. It doesn't mean that at all. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, هُوَ الَّذِي جَعَلَ لَكُمُ الْأَرْضَ ذَلُولًا فَامْشُوا فِي مَنَاكِبِهَا وَكُلُوا مِنْ رِزْقِهِ وَإِلَيْهِ النُّشُورُ. Allah is telling us that everything in this dunya was created for the sake of the human being, for your sake. Everything in this dunya is halal for you until you have an evidence from the Quran, the authentic sunnah that is haram. I don't have all the time to be in the masjid. I don't have all the time to wear this thawb, this galbayan, this kind of hat. I don't have to do that. I can wear whatever I want as long as it's not something haram. I can eat whatever I want. I can or I'm asking but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to have better position, better educational degree, better job to help myself and my community. فامشوا في مناديبها وكلوا من رزقي ولا يجوا. But at the same time your heart is connected to the akhirah. قال الله عز وجل it is he, Allah, who made the earth tame for you. So walk among its slopes and eat of its provision. Walk among its slopes, go find a job. Find a better life for yourself and your family and your whole ummah. وإليه النشور. And to him, Allah, in the resurrection. Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, when the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam taught him this lesson, he understood it. And he gave us another lesson. قال عبد الله بن عمر في صحيح البخاري إذا أمسيت فلا تنتظر الصلاة وإذا أصبحت فلا تنتظر المساء وخذ من صحتك لسقمك ومن حياتك لموتك. قال عبد الله بن عمر when you survive until the morning don't expect to live until the evening and when you survive until the evening don't expect to live until the morning and do good deeds when you are in good health before you fall sick and do good deeds as long as you're alive before death strikes before death befalls you. When you come to the masjid, when you come 5 times a day to pray, when you go to listen to a lecture, you're going to help your people, you're going to give or to listen to a lecture, just try to accompany your children. They should start worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the early ages. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said, إِذَا مَرِضَ الْعَبْدَ وَسَافَرْ كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَوْ أَجْرَ مَا كَانَ يَعْمَلُ صَحِيحًا مُقِيمًا. If a person became sick, or he traveled and he can't worship Allah as he used to do while he was healthy and not traveling and staying in his city, Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said, Allah will reward you the same. He will reward you the same. For example, every day you used to pray in the masjid 5 times. You used to recite 2 pages in the Quran. To pray 2 rak'ahs at night. But something happened, you had to travel, and you can't continue doing that. Or you became sick, you became old. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward you the same. Look at the mercy of Allah. That the meaning of the same said Abu Umar, وَخُذْ مِنْ صَحَّتِكَ لِسَقَمِكَ. You're a young man, worship Allah. One day you will become sick, you will become old. وَخُذْ مِنْ حَيَاتِكَ لِمَوْتِكَ صلى الله عليه وسلم. Here we have a man who came to the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام to ask him a very beautiful question that every one of us wants to have a direct answer from the Prophet to that question. رواه الإمام ابن ماجة وغيره بأسانيد حسان عن سهل بن سعد الساعدي قال جاء رجل إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وقال يا رسول الله دلني على عمل إذا عملته أحبني الله وأحبني الناس. A man came to the Prophet said, يا رسول الله please tell me an action if I do Allah will love me. And an action if I do people will love me. Who doesn't want people to love him? Especially the righteous people. If the righteous people in this masjid or any other masjid they love you for the sake of Allah, it's an evidence, clear evidence that Allah loves you. Because of what? Because the Prophet said, مَا مِنْ عَبْدٍ إِلَّا وَلَهُ صِيْتٌ فِي السَّمَاءِ فَإِنْ كَانَ صِيْتُهُ فِي السَّمَاءِ حَسَنًا وُضِعَ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَإِنْ كَانَ صِيْتُهُ فِي السَّمَاءِ سَيِّئًا وُضِعَ فِي الْأَرْضِ. Of many people in our community, mashallah, everybody loves them. Everybody, whenever you mention this name, everybody loves him. Because he has a good reputation in the heavens, so he has the same in the earth. So everybody wants people to love him. You agree with that? We have a general answer in the Quran, and then the Prophet ﷺ is giving a specific answer in this situation when he was asking that question. The general answer in the Quran, قال الله عز وجل, إن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات سيجعل لهم الرحمن ودا محبة في قلوب الخلق.
Indeed, those who have believed and their righteous deeds, the most merciful, Allah will appoint for them affection. Inhumah, the righteous deed. And if you want Allah to love you, here is a general answer. قال تعالى قل إن كنتم تحبون الله فاتبعوني يحببكم الله ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم والله غفور رحيم. Say, O Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, if you should love Allah, then follow me, so Allah will love you and forgive for your sins. Allah is forgiving and merciful. So what is the specific action? If I do, Allah will love me and people will love me. The man is still asking. قال النبي صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم يا هذا ازهد في الدنيا يحبك الله وازهد فيما أيد وازهد فيما في أيدي الناس يحبك الناس عليك الصلاة والسلام. He said to him, the answer is, have no desire in this world and Allah will love you. And have no desire in what people possess and people will love you. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You have a car, but someone has a better car than yours. It is not haram to wish that you had a better car than your car. But the haram thing is to ask Allah to take his car away and to give it to you. That is the haram envy. So you can compete in this life, have better job, better educational degree. You are required to do that, to be strong. A strong Muslim is better in the sight of Allah than a weak Muslim. But at the same time, it's just a new hand, not a new heart. And he said, عليه الصلاة والسلام, وزد فيما في أيدي الناس يحبك الناس. Here is a very important point. There's someone, inshallah, some people, they have good car, but still they are asking people for help. Good houses, they still asking people for help. People will be displeased with you after some time. قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من لم يسأل الله يغضب عليه. Whoever doesn't beg Allah for everything he wants, Allah will become displeased with him. And with people, it's the opposite. If you keep asking people for one time, two times, three times, they will help you. But you still asking, but you can have job, you can work, you're not disabled, you're good. But you don't want to work. You just want people to help you. Be very careful. People will hate that. They won't help you anymore. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves that for you if you ask Him. When you deal with Allah, deal with Him as a child. Ask Him whatever you want. If He doesn't give you, cry and ask Him. If He doesn't give you in the dunya, He will keep it for you in the hereafter. And He said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَإِنَّا إِدَّخِرَهَا لَوْ فِي الْآخِرَةِ He will save your du'as for you to benefit you within the hereafter, inshaAllah. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم. الحمد لله حمد الحمد شكرا وشكرا شكرا شكرا لا إله إلا الله شكرا أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. سيدنا عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه in his time the Muslim state became very strong because they had many factories and many countries were conquered in his time رضي الله عنه. One time he was talking about what people have gained of the properties, of the luxuries of this life, and then he compared that to the life of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. Allah was giving the Sahaba a listen, رضي الله عنه. في حديث النعمان بن بشير عن في صحيح مسلم يقول ذكر عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه ما أصاب الناس من الدنيا. أنت يا عمر رضي الله عنه وصل with his Sahaba and he started to talk about the luxury that the people live in nowadays. في العصر الذهبي عصر سيدنا عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه. And then he said, just come back a little bit to the history to see the life of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. I'm just reminding you of the life of the Prophet. He's saying that Umar. Then he said, لقد رأيت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يظل اليوم يلتوي ما يجد من الدقل ما يملأ به بطنه. والدقل هو رديء التمر. يسوع رضي الله عنه, I saw the messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم who passed his days in hunger and couldn't get even degraded dates to fill his stomach عليه الصلاة والسلام. You can imagine to that extent he used to give everything in charity for the sake of Allah. He wasn't poor صلى الله عليه وسلم. قال الله عز وجل أَلَمْ يَجِدَكَ يَتِيمًا فَآوَى وَوَجَدَكَ ضَالًّا فَهَدَى وَوَجَدَكَ عَيْنًا فَأَغْنَى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him everything, but he used to give everything for the sake of Allah عليه الصلاة والسلام. And by the way, I'm not asking you to give everything for the sake of Allah. Because he said to Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As, وَالثُّلُثُ كَثِيرٌ إِنَّكَ إِنْ تَذَرَ رَوَثَتَكَ أَغْنِيَاءُ خَيْرٌ لَكَ مِنْ أَنْ تَذَرَهُمْ عَالَةً يَتَكَفَّفُونَ النَّاسِ. If you want to give one third of your wealth for the sake of Allah, that's fine, but it's too much. And then he said to him, if you leave your children after your death, if you leave them rich, you have enough, it's better for you than leaving them in need, begging people, asking people for help. Sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. So that's how we should understand this dunya, to deal with it as a stranger, as a traveler, and ask Allah to give the dunya in your hands, but not in your heart, because your heart is connected to the Akhirah. وأقول قولي هذا وإني داع فأل منه. اللهم اغفر ذنوبنا, اللهم اغفر ذنوبنا, واستر عيوبنا, وتول أمرنا, وأحسن خلاصنا. اللهم اجعل الدنيا في أيدينا ولا تجعلها في قلوبنا. اللهم اجعل الدنيا في أيدينا ولا تجعلها في قلوبنا. اللهم ألف بين قلوبنا وأصلح ذات بيننا. انزع الغل والحقد من صدورنا. اللهم طهر صدورنا وصف نفوسنا, واجعلنا سلما لاخواننا هداة لغيرنا. وصل اللهم وسلم وزد وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى اله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. واقم الصلاه.